The subject this morning is, what does God lack? We wonder, how can God lack anything being perfect? God does not lack anything except under certain conditions. And those certain conditions are that he thought he would like to enjoy himself, so he created this dream of life, this drama of life. And in that drama, he made all of us. And in the hearts of each and every one of us, he placed, naturally, his unconditional love. Now you think of your own dream. You can, in your dream, create many souls. And in the hearts of those souls, you can place your love, can't you? And then you can give those people that you have created in your dream independence, free will, to accept that love and return it to you and join with you in consciousness, or you can let them circumscribe it by lesser loves of attachment and so forth. Can't you do that? And when you wake up and that dream has been resolved, there you are, the same united consciousness of oneness. But from that has come this dream. And in that dream, where you give the character free will to keep or reject something, in this case your love, then while you're in that dream, you lack that one thing. So God is the same way. He doesn't lack anything, of course. He is omniscient. All things are in him. But in the dream of life, in his creation, he has made it that way. Remember that. Only in the creation that he has created does he lack one thing, and that's our love, because he gave us independence. He gave us free will to accept his love or reject him, to circumscribe it with lesser loves, as I shall try to point out. Now there is one great force in the universe, and that is the force of God's love. That's the greatest force. That is the one force in the universe, and all law hangs on that one force. That force has two parts. One is the creative aspect, which goes out from God, the great force of repulsion, and the other is that great attractive force, the pull of all things back to God. That's the greatest force in the universe. That force is greater than his power of will or repulsion. Now that force of repulsion, we can contact right within our own beings at the Christ Center here. When you do anything through will, you put your attention there, and sometimes you squint up your eyebrows and you go to it. Because this is the seat of the great force of repulsion in us, the Christ Center. Now, the other aspect of that one great force of God's great love, outside of the creative force, is, as I have said, the great force of attraction. The greatest force in the universe, because all things go back to God. The great force of God's love. Unconditional divine love. That's what the greatest force in the universe is. And in us, where do we find that? In the heart. You can see the light of the eternal flame of God at this point. It gives you great power and strength. But until you feel in your heart its component part, the great law of attraction, God's divine love, which is pulling you back to him, until you feel that, you have not really known what God's unconditional divine love is. So remember, in us, the seed of divine love, the greatest force in the universe, remember that. God is love, we read in the scripture. God is love. The seed of that in you, in me, and in all of his created creatures is in the heart center. And so you can see the cultivation of the will center at this point is necessary. The light of God is most alluring, gives you great power and strength, but when his divine love comes in your heart, then nothing else matters so great as the pull of God's presence in you. Now we read this in the scripture decidedly as I have just said. We read as follows in Matthew, the 22nd verse, 36 to 40th, 22nd chapter, 36 to 40th verse. Listen carefully. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto them, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. When you feel the divine love of God in your heart, when you have cleared the heart of all dross, and the heart is pure gold, then you can love your neighbor as yourself, because you see there is no difference between God's love in him and in you. Finally, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So there you see why God's love is the greatest force in the universe. Everything depends on that great force of God's great love. His whole creation, greatest of all, that great attractive power in that love of God, which is drawing all things back into his bosom. Now this great force of attraction, as I have said, unconditional love, is drawing all things in creation and is drawing each one of us back to God, and will continue to draw us back to God until finally, we merge in his great unconditional love in our hearts and go back home. He will never give up trying. He wants us. He wants us to come back to him. The greatest thing he wants is that. But he has given us independence, free will, to accept him or reject him, to use our choice in following the lesser love, a political, social, individual, human attached love. He has given us the choice through free will, and he does not want to take away our independence. And so that's the one thing God lacks, is that love, the natural love in our heart, unconditional. God wants it, but he hates to take away our independence, so he does not have it. But he is drawing everything back to him, and will continue to draw all things back to him, because in the 180th Psalm we read, his mercy endureth forever. And the mercy of God is what? It's unconditional love in our hearts. It will never stop. His mercy will be there waiting for you, but you, until you do away with circumscribed loves, and merge in the one unconditional divine love, until you do away with conditioned love, as I have said, individual, social, human love, conditioned, and know the unconditional love of God, you will have to suffer and be disappointed until finally you merge in his great love in your heart. Remember, his mercy endureth forever. But in the meantime, we will never be satisfied with anything less than God's unconditional love within us. The Master has spoken nicely of this in the 86th Preceptor. Those of you who are students might read it. Divine love, as I have said, is that great attractive force of the universe, which is pulling all things back to God. As Ramakrishna said, all will be saved, which is right. But why not follow the path of self-realization and hasten the time? Why wait? So the Master wrote, divine love is coaxing through gravitational magnetic pull to melt all matter into his space bosom. Divine love is flooding as flames through the sluice gates of hearts to inundate and destroy all ignorance, erected boundaries, ignorance erected boundaries of individual, social, patriotic, and human love attachment. Now, human love is all right. Human love is from God's divine love in us. We cannot deny that. When you, those of you who have children, you know how you feel toward the children. Those of you who have dear friends, how do you feel toward them? You feel with that love which God has placed in your heart. But His is unconditioned. But perhaps you as parents are not practicing unconditional love on your children. If you realize that it is because of God that you have those children, if you realize that because of God you have your husband or your wife or your dear friend, if you thoroughly realize that, then you love them with that unconditional love, then you are all right. Then, no attachment is laid up. It is the attachment that does it. The attachment, due to free will and choice, is what binds us to the lesser loves of life. But if you feel that the source of all love is God's great unconditional love and keep it as such, then you will never lose. You will not lose the love of your children. You will get a far greater love from your children, and the relationship between you and your children or your relatives or your friends will be on a high level of unconditional divine love. That's the key. That's the key to not allowing attachment to enter into the love within your heart. Remember, divine love, God is the source. He is the giver. It is because of Him that we have those near and dear to us. All He asks is that you do not use your free choice in forgetting that and allowing attachment to your children or friends or relatives to creep in. That He doesn't like because He's the sole giver. Would you like it? God doesn't like that. But still, He doesn't do anything about it. He says, well, I will wait for them. They will find out gradually. So He's been waiting, perhaps for incarnation, for us to realize that one great eternal truth. So remember, human love is all right. And you will not lose when you love your children if you supersede that human love, whereby attachment may creep in. If you supersede that by divine love, then you are safe. Instead of losing, you will gain God's great love, which is the greatest force and the greatest thing in the universe. So remember, human love is only wrong when there is possession. Because when you have children and you possess them, what do? You take away the freedom of that soul. But if you love them with God's love, instead of possessing them, then you help them gain freedom, which is their birthright. So human love, remember, must not contain attachment or possession. Now going on about this divine unconditional love of God, this is natural in our heart. The natural love of the heart is there. And the natural love is in all things, all created things. We see this in animals, in humans, in the birds. We see how they love their young. Of course, they love them, I think, in the right way, because when the little bird gets big enough to just about get his wings going, the mother throws him out, makes him strong. Do we do that to our children? Nevertheless, that natural love in the heart is present in all of God's created creatures, and we see it. And remember, we do not have to create. Men say to me, I can't get that devotion going. Well, men are made a little different than the ladies. But I find when you just help them a little that they are very devoted. Why? Because the heart's natural love is there. You don't have to create it. It is pulling at your heartstrings to take you back once more to God. So it isn't something we have to create. The heart's natural love is in everyone. Sometimes it's pretty well covered up, isn't it? But nevertheless, it is there. The heart's natural love. And because God has placed it there, He has placed it in our heart, then he unconditionally gave us freedom and independence because of that. That's the thing God lacks. Remember that. And he lacks it because he himself, of his own free will, created this dream, and he wants us to have the same free will that he had. That's how big God is. And yet, as the Master used to say, he wants us more than we want him. He's trying to pull us back more than we are trying to find him. Sometimes we wonder. But when the saints tell us, we must realize that it is true. And when you meditate deeply and feel the great pull of God's omniscient love in your heart, really feel it, then you'll know why the Master said he wants us more than we want him, and you'll know why the scriptures say it's the greatest force in the universe, the attraction of God's divine love. Now going on a bit here, as I have said, God has given us that love unconditionally, but we have circumscribed it by lesser love, because he gave us free will and because we used our free will and choice to accept these barriers of these other lives, individual, social, patriotic, and human love attachment. Those are the things which circumscribe the natural love in the heart. And God does not want to take away our independence, having once given it to us. And because of that, we do not feel and completely merge in his one great love. And these lesser loves, we are shipwrecked on the rocks of attachment. That's the point. By following these lesser loves, missing God's great unconditional love, we are dead to that high realization of what unconditional love of God is, the greatest force in the universe. We are dead to it. We are dead to the greatest thing we have, our birthright, oneness with God's great love. A little story comes to my mind just to relieve the tension just a little bit. This young man climbed up on his father's knee and was reading the paper, and he said, "Dad," he said, "who killed the Dead Sea?" And the father said, "I don't know, son, but if you know, let me know and I'll get you a good lawyer." So we don't want to be like the Dead Sea. Dead to that presence of God within us. Dead to the fullness of his love. And that's what we are by these circumscribed loves of attachment. Attachment is the worst thing. It's so difficult when you see my child. He's my child. He's better than any other youngster. Why? Because he's my child. It's very difficult to break that. But if you see the one light of God and see in your child and in every other child the same light of God, then there can be no attachment. Then you realize that the one unconditional love of God is in every sincere heart. So we must watch out that our ship of soul does not land on the rocks of attachment through lesser loves than God's one great unconditional love. Now going on a little further, we come to the point about how the soul is going to escape from its predicament of attachment. How can the soul escape from the predicament it finds itself in, that in these lesser loves it is not satisfied? The soul will never be satisfied in anything except God's divine love. What is the soul going to do about it? What it's going to do? It's going to, as we say in our prayer, "Father, may I awaken thy love in all true hearts." The soul must try to find divine unconditioned love by awakening that in the hearts of all. When we do that, when the soul does that, then the divine love in the soul will grow. And when it grows, then God can come. And then it can merge in the all-encompassing, unconditional love of God. That has to grow first, remember. That love has to grow. That unconditional love in the heart, the natural love in the heart, has to grow into divine love. Then God can come and reclaim that which he does not have, the love in our heart. But it never can come until it is unconditional, unconditioned by anything, the divine love in the heart. Now comes the point. That's why the Guru comes. If it were not for the Guru or the channel which he has sent, this is the important point this morning I want you to remember. If it were not for the Guru and the channel which he represents, which God has ordained, if it were not for that, you could never, never realize unconditional divine love. You cannot do it except through the channel God has sent, through the channel of the Master in this particular case, and the great souls which are behind the movement. Because only in those divine personages can you feel unconditional divine love. How are you going to make your love unconditional and divine unless you know and see it in someone and follow them? You cannot do it. It's impossible. Sri Yukteswarji wrote beautifully in his little book, The Holy Science, these words. With the help of this developed love, that is, when you feel God's love in the hearts of all, by your own effort, that's not full unconditional love, but that's the beginning. When you do that, then what happens? This is what happens. With the help of this developed love, man becomes fortunate in securing the God-like company of divine personages or the Guru Preceptor and is saved forever. Remember, this is the important thing. When you try and cultivate that divine love within you by feeling it in the hearts of others, then God sends you the right channel whereby you can feel unconditional divine love. Then you can be one with that unconditional divine love. This is very important. People do not realize how important it is. So, that is why God created the Guru and gave the spiritual channel, so that through that agency, we could appreciate and realize unconditional divine love and allow him to take us back home. Unless you appreciate that, and you can only appreciate it when you feel it in the heart of the Guru. Now the Guru isn't here personally, but that love is here. He has left it in his teaching. That unconditional divine love is there. Now, when you feel that through the channel which God has sent, then your love is expanded and God can say, now come back home to me. Now come back and once more merge in my unconditional divine love. Sri Yukteswarji's words to the Master are most beautiful. I shall be your friend forever. Where can you find that except in a Guru? Unconditional love. He said to Paramhansaji, I shall be your friend forever because God asked me to bring you home. Isn't that wonderful? And I know in mixing with the Master, which I have for many years, until I met him and felt that, I never knew what unconditional love was. Never entered my head. And when I felt it in him, then I realized. And then the Guru can help you expand your love. Expand it from the circumscribed love, which we have accepted through free choice. He can help you expand it into that unconditional divine love of God, which cannot be expressed in words. which has to be felt. Now, when you feel that, then God has no trouble in drawing your love back to Him. Unconditional divine love. So, the delusion of conditioned love is too great. I don't think you can do it without the channel. The delusion of conditioned love is too great for you to overcome. And that's why God sent the channel of the Guru and the Great One. Because through them, they can help you expand your love until you can hold God's unconditional divine love. That's the point to surely remember, is that you alone, due to the delusion of these lesser loves, conditioned love, is terrific. You cannot alone do it. That's why God created these things. Why He created the Guru and the channel of the great masters Jesus Christ and those. That we might be able to feel the unconditional love of God, then He can take us back to His kingdom. That's your passport into the kingdom of heaven, is the full realization of the unconditional love in your heart. As the Master used to say to me, the heart must be pure gold, there can't be any dross. I didn't know what he meant. Now I do. If there's a little bit of dross, of attachment and condition, that great divine love of God, the greatest force in the universe, cannot flow through you. But the Guru and the channel he has left, remember, created by God, ordained by God, was done by God for the sole purpose of helping us rise above something which we could not rise above without His help, the attached love. So remember how important the channel which God has sent you and sent me, ordained it to be so. We must be loyal to it 100%. If we are not, we are disrespectful to God. Don't forget that. I am talking now to those who are members of the fellowship. Those who are new here, I know that you don't know about self-realization. But I do know that if you investigate it open-mindedly, without any prejudice, you will feel the unconditional love of God in this movement which God has sent here. You will feel it. Then when you join, for heaven's sake, be 100% loyal to something God has sent you in response to your heart cry, in response to your prayers, be 100% loyal to the channel He has sent. Don't let people say, come and listen to this and listen to that. Follow it. Follow it until you have thoroughly tested it, and I haven't any question as to the result. I know once, having really found the divine love of God which has been sent through this channel, you will never leave it. That's the conviction I have after many, many years of struggling and finding out for my own self. And so, in conclusion, once having tasted this divine love which has been sent through this channel of God, try to awaken it in the hearts of all. And if you do that, then that divine love, which is natural in your heart, because you have accepted the channel which God has sent, will grow and will blossom forth. And then God can come, and receive that which He does not have because He gave us free will to accept Him or reject Him. He will come, finding that which He most desires because He has everything else in the universe except that one thing, that natural love in your heart. He hasn't that. But when He finds that you are ready to give it to Him, just think of what a reunion that is. You cannot imagine it. But those who meditate deeply will know of what I am talking. As I have said, it is wonderful to see the spiritual light at this point. It is most helpful. It gives you great power. and it gives you great consolation. But when in deep meditation, you enter the light at this point and feel in your heart the presence of God, the force is terrific. You are sucked up into the light. And whether you have this body or have it not makes no difference. Such is the power of unconditional love of God. These are actual experiences I'm not telling you from reading books. These are facts. The power of God's unconditional divine love is supreme in the universe. If you once get into it and you feel Him drawing you up, you cannot resist it. Body is nothing. Worlds are nothing. The only thing that matters is that you and God have finally become one.